You're listening to Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. We're coming to you from the unceded traditional territories of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations around Vancouver, BC. I'm your host, Bernadine Fox, and this is the show that dares to change how we think about mental health. Welcome to Rethreading Madness. Today I speak with Norman Leech. He is a hard man to pin down only because he is very busy and a much sought-after advisor here in Vancouver, BC. In this hour, I'm going to encourage you to open up your heart and your mind to hearing and thinking in a new way about mental health. Norman is here to talk with us about decolonizing therapy.
100.5 means non-commercial, listener-powered, community radio. 100.5 means music, public affairs,
I have a dream,
and arts programming.
I wish I loved the human race. I wish I loved its city face.
You won't find anywhere else on the radio dial. 100.5 is not owned by a huge corporation. We are owned and operated by people like you, by your community. 100.5 CFRO Vancouver Cooperative Radio. Find our complete program schedule at cooperadio.org.
You're listening to Rethreading Madness on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox, and right now I have the pleasure of speaking with Norman Leech. Norman, can you give us an idea of who you are?
Sure, Bernadine. I usually just use Norm Leech. I'm currently the executive director at the Frog Hollow Neighbourhood House. I've been there just over a year. Previous to that, I was the executive director at the Vancouver Aboriginal Community Policing Center. I was born in East Van. Grew up in East Van. I'm an East Van kid. My ancestry is in the Tlaytlet community of the Tlaytlet Nation. Our community surrounds the town of Lillooet, for people who know that area of the province. And yeah, so I've lived there. I've lived in Vancouver most of my life. And work in Indigenous agencies, helping the people as much as I can for most of my life. I'm also a recovering alcoholic addict. I did end up in the downtown east side and spent a lot of time down there, I guess, conducting my advanced research in addiction and alcoholism. And I learned a great deal, but have since survived and graduated from there. It's been more than 30 years since I had to use alcohol or drugs.
That's wonderful. The reason we're talking today is because you also teach about decolonizing therapy, and it's a fascinating topic to me, and I was hoping that you could start out by telling us, what does that mean?
Well, that journey begins when I was with the Community Policing Center, and they were working with a form of therapeutic approach called Indigenous Focusing Oriented Therapy, developed by Shirley Turcotte. And it built on earlier forms of body-centered approach to trauma, mm-hmm. but went further, and then went further than simply the body, and went to connections to land. And then through connections to land, getting connections to ancestors. And that really made sense to Indigenous people from across the country. So I entered the training very skeptical, had sort of experienced various forms of therapy that, you know, took some Indigenous words and some teachings and then slapped them on and claimed indigeneity. But this was different. So it wasn't long before I really believed that this had its roots in the ancient ways that I believe our communities operated, in their sense of connection to land and ancestors. And through that, tapping into the original sources of all our strength and health and power, and reconnecting with that to overcome the many challenges and especially the traumas that Indigenous people, and especially the ones in the city, are experiencing, and not finding great success with any of the other standard Western psychotherapy approaches to the depths of the trauma that the people here have survived and are trying to heal. So these tools made sense and they worked. And they work with the people that we use them with. So there's quite a number of practitioners and therapists out there using these tools now, including myself. And so the group of therapists also and surely developed a subset of those tools that they call Indigenous Tools for Living, which helps frontline workers especially create a different relationship with trauma. So that we don't fear it, we don't hate it, we don't avoid it. What we develop is a kind and curious relationship with trauma, so that we understand it, we recognize where it came from, and most of all, we recognize that we already survived it. So noticing that we already survived it, then we start to ask, well, who else owns this? Who else is a part of this trauma? And then the more we ask questions into it, the more you understand that it's not all yours. It belongs to the people who committed it. It belongs to the people who stood by. It belongs to the people who knew and did nothing. And the more you do that, the more you understand that very little of it is yours. And then once you understand that, then you can realize that you can set it down and you don't have to carry it around. So modern research on trauma recognizes vicarious trauma, that we pick it up from all the people around us, that all the trauma that's occurring around us and that the people around us are carrying. And it's our nature. And it's good that we want to help our friends and our families and our colleagues with their trauma. So we do. But no one ever taught us how to set it down. So these tools help us set it down, recognize what isn't ours, and let the land take it. So recognizing how much the land loves us and has always loved us. And that's demonstrated in the way that the land, and we don't think of the land as property. The land is our relative. She's our ancestor. She's our great, great, greatest grandmother. And if you think of all that she's given us everything forever. Every food or water or medicine or shelter that we ever needed was gifted to us by her. And so that is, by definition, love. So if you understand how much the land loves you, every cell and molecule of your body, every second of your life, then you know that she will take all of that. And you also know that she takes it all in the end anyway. Mm-hmm. So all we do is do it now. And help people understand and give them methods and tools and techniques so that they can set those down. And they don't have to. They can keep them. They can carry them. And we do pick up more every day. But if we can continue to keep setting it down and pick up less of it, then it helps us maintain better health and strength and happiness so that we can actually go out and help more people. So we've been sharing those tools with frontline workers in the downtown Eastside Vancouver throughout the pandemic. So it's probably been 4 or 5 years now, and probably a few hundred people have the training, and we believe that they suffer less trauma, less stress, less burnout, and are able to help more people on the front lines because of it.
And so this is a tool that you're providing for support workers and counselors and people who work with others who've been traumatized. Do you also do this work with those who've experienced the trauma?
Right. One of the prime mandates of the community policing center was working with the families of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. Mm-hmm. And so we worked closely with Butterflies in Spirit and Lorelei Williams. And so we were a go-to agency for those families. And many of them have received these tools to help them manage that trauma. And many of them access trained counselors who are trained in the therapeutic approach using these tools as well. And so many, many, many people have benefited from these and have taken them back to community and have advocated to their community offices and health services and even chiefs and councils that these are tools and methods that are rooted in an Indigenous connection to land and ancestors and are therefore much more effective. They make more sense and they work better. And then what we found is through my work in repairing relations between Indigenous community in Vancouver and the settler, immigrant, refugee communities, those agencies reached out and wanted to restore relations because they were historically bad. We're both fed so much misinformation and stereotypes and lies about each other that we just have these beliefs about each other that they're taking more than their fair share, that they're taking stuff at our expense. And we've both been fed this zero-sum game narrative that is simply incorrect, but it divides us. But the more we understand that they too suffered the effects of colonization. Colonization was not invented here. Mm-mm. I think it was perfected here. But it was invented everywhere else long before it got here. And so all these people who are arriving here in Vancouver in Canada, if they go back into their family history 5, 10, 20 generations, they encounter colonization and its many effects and its many traumas. And so then if I help them remember and think back into their family histories, then I say, that's what we're experiencing here and now. And it creates a common understanding and a desire to help each other. Mm-hmm. So then it builds relations between the organizations and the people.
And that is so healthy. By comparison to the alternative, it's a very healthy way of moving forward.
And it builds relations. So I've built so many, not only, you know, colleagues and clients, but friends across these what have historically been divides. So it's been very rewarding, and I really enjoy the work, and enjoy meeting the people, and really getting an enthusiastic and a heartfelt response to form alliance and to form coalition and to find ways of helping each other. And it's not just one way. It's not just one group helping the other. It's both helping each other because we both face such similar challenges.
Mm-hmm. True. If you were to compare what you're doing to a more colonized version of therapy, how would you define that? Like, how would you define colonized therapy at this point?
It's very individualistic, right? Mm. It basically divides every single person into an individual and examines them from what is troubling you, right? And what can we all do to help you? Mm-hmm. So again, figure out what is your problem. But this approach actually says, no, you are not alone. You are part of your community. You are part of your family. You are part of this land. You are part of this earth. You are part of this universe. And as such, you have much to offer the collective, and you can draw on the collective strengths of not only of everyone who's here, but from the land itself. And not only those who are here now, but the ancestors as well. And once people start to recognize that they are part of this grander collective, then it overcomes those senses of isolation and separation and loneliness that is absolutely common throughout the world today.
Mm-hmm.
Like the fastest growing mental health challenge in cities around the world is loneliness.
Mm-hmm.
What a disaster. How can that be?
Yeah, it does seem preposterous considering we live in a community that have many, 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 many people in it. We just need to take a little break, Norman, but we'll be right back, folks.
It's estimated that 1 in 2 Canadians will be diagnosed with cancer in their lifetime. For many, the physical, emotional, and financial burdens are heavy. The Volunteer Cancer Driver Society ensures they never have to worry about a ride to and from treatment, offering safe, reliable, and free transportation for all patients. Now they're expanding their service across the mainland, and they need more volunteer drivers to join their fleet. If you have a vehicle, a valid driver's license with at least 5 years of experience, and a passion for helping those in need, the Volunteer Cancer Driver Society would love to have you. Visit volunteercancerdrivers.ca to learn more.
You're listening to Rethreading Madness on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox, having the pleasure of speaking with Norman Leech about decolonizing therapy. Norman, you were just talking about how decolonizing therapy is different than colonized forms of therapy. And as you were talking, I was realizing that one of the biggest things that I perceive as a mental health consumer about therapy is that in a biggest portion of what is colonized about it is the notion of power, the imbalance of power, right? And so, and I also work with people where therapists have tried to ignore that imbalance of power and have done great harm. But all in all, when you look at it from the outside, at the mental health structure that is out there, the infrastructure that is developed to work with mental health consumers, you have a system where the therapists have power over and the person who is considered ill or sick, not that I would use those terms, is the one who is disempowered and is told to simply do as they're told, and they will get better. How is it different when you're working with decolonizing therapy? How is that power imbalance handled?
Well, largely, it's learning to recognize what are the characteristics of the colonized systems. And so the medical care system is a prime example of the colonized way of doing it. And in fact, colonization causes trauma. If you look mm-hmm. at human history, what is the greatest source of trauma ever invented that has harmed humans throughout history? And man, it's rooted in colonization and the values and behaviors that come along with it. So to expect colonized systems, the current medical system, to develop solutions to the problems caused by colonized systems is unreasonable. It's not going to happen. It's not going to work. So we'd seek answers outside of those colonized systems. So recognizing that some of the outcomes of colonized systems are the separation, division, isolation of individuals. So the Indigenous worldview is that we are connected. We are related. We say, all my relations, which means all my relationships with everything, everywhere, every when. Not just my family, not just the humans, but everything, the land, the ancestors, the universe. And in that is access to the greater power, not the power of prescription medicines or pharmaceuticals, not the power of some doctorate, but the power of everything that has gone into making you who you are. And in the recognition that we are much more than our traumas. So the recognition that we already survived it, which means that we must have had whatever it took, the characteristics, the gifts, the skills, the qualities that were needed to survive that trauma. So honor that and accept that you had what it took. And you inherited that from all your ancestors who also had what it took to survive every trauma that they faced, right? You are descended from the survivors. And remember, not everybody survived. Many did not. But your ancestors had more strength, more courage, more survival skills than every trauma that they faced. And they must have, because they survived. And the evidence is that you are here. And we can say that to everyone who's here now today.
Yeah, that's undeniable. If you're here, you've survived whatever you've gone through. You've already survived it.
And all your ancestors survived.
Exactly. Or you wouldn't be here. Absolutely.
You are selected. In Darwinian terms, you are selected for survival. And that shows up for Indigenous people, especially in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
So even though we still suffer the highest rates of every negative social health indicator that's measured, shorter life expectancy, higher incarceration, more children in care, higher rates of murder, suicide, violent crime, lower education rates, lower income levels, higher rates of death due to COVID-19, HIV/AIDS, substance use, overdose, every negative social health indicator, we're in the top three of every one.
Mm-hmm.
Who's the fastest growing population in the country?
Aboriginal people.
Who's the only naturally growing population in the country? Us.
First Nations. Yeah, absolutely.
We have survivor spirit. We can survive just about anything. And now, all we have to do is heal it. And we're learning how. Unfortunately, we're becoming experts in healing trauma because we have to. But we're figuring it out. And we're figuring out the greatest source of our trauma is all those tools of colonization that have been used so effectively against us. And we're learning to use them back against the colonization itself.
That's an incredible statement. Can you tell me what kind of colonization tools you're using?
Well, the first step is noticing the harm that it's causing us. So because I worked in the so-called justice field with urban Indigenous people, learning to recognize that, you know what, these systems of written laws that were written here in Canada were never designed or intended to provide justice to Indigenous people.
No.
And the way we can tell that is we did not write one of them. Mm-hmm. Not one of them is written in our language. Not one of them reflects our Indigenous understanding of what is justice. And as far as I can tell, each of these laws is designed and intended to advance and complete colonization. And to that effect, every single one of them is working perfectly, every second of every day. And the greatest barrier to that ultimate goal and objective is us.
Mm-hmm.
So the sooner we recognize that, the sooner we recognize that the answer is not more laws. The answer is not reform of the justice of the so-called justice system. The answer is a decolonization of the concept of justice. And then to start to help other people understand that, you know what, this so-called justice system was not designed or intended to provide justice for you either. And all you have to do is look at who wrote the laws in this country and in most colonized countries around the world. Well, it ends up being a small subset of the population. And usually it's represented by the old, the wealthy, the colonized, the educated men. And then you have a look and you say, well, who benefits the most and gets the most protections from these laws? Well, what a coincidence. The old, wealthy, colonized, educated men. And who gets the least protections and benefits from those laws? The young, the poor, the Indigenous, the uneducated, the women.
Mm-hmm.
What a brilliant system.
Well, I guess you said young, so yeah.
It's brilliant in its design and structure and implementation, and that's just one of the powerful tools. Language itself, this English language, man, it is good about writing laws, denoting property, and imposing power and control over others. Other systems, the education system, holy cow, it's brilliant in its design and its effectiveness. It churns out citizens and consumers and workers perfectly. And then the other specialized education systems, police academy turns out police officers, law school churn out lawyers. They're it's brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
Don't even get me started on
right.
Diabolically brilliant. That's one of my most common phrase these days. And then organized religion. Wow, it was used so effectively against us to alter people's behavior and make them behave in terrible ways and make other people accept those behaviors.
I actually read recently, I didn't read the book, but I was made aware of and saw the cover of a book that worked off of, really to bring awareness to the fact that in the mid-1800s, there was a man in the U.S. who had developed a means of using Christianity to make his slaves more submissive, and it was literally sold that way as how to use Christianity to get control of your slaves. And I thought, wow, that fits so much into the whole idea of residential schools, right? In terms of being created and controlled and by the churches around here.
Well, not only brilliant, but it's flexible and adaptable too. Wow.
Yeah, when you use a religion and you get somebody to buy into that religion, then they become their own control mechanism because their absolute beliefs that they've been inculcated with will control them, right?
Well, and the systems are so well designed that they don't even need actual people anymore to protect them, to defend them, to maintain them. Just try and get rid of a law. Try and get rid of the Indian Act. It's almost impossible because it's the system maintains itself. It's brilliant.
And so let me just take that a little bit farther. How is that system different than, say, what existed as law, and I say that in quotes, in the Indigenous communities that were here in Canada prior to white people showing up and imposing their laws?
Well, every community, every nation across the continent had laws. We just never wrote them down, right? Which modern people would, and colonized people would say, oh, well, that's so primitive and that's ineffective and everything becomes an argument. Well, no, it's actually the written laws that end up causing way more arguments. Everybody argues over the original meaning of the American Constitution or the Bible or any ancient text. But in Indigenous communities where it was oral, it demanded that in order to resolve disputes, we had to have the conversation. But it wasn't just this person and this person. We had to balance all the interests of the salmon itself, the interests of the river, the interests of the community, the interests of the families, the interests of the children yet to come, and the ancestors who'd been there before. We balanced all those interests in those conversations, and we managed amazingly well for 10,000 years here on these territories. We lived everywhere, right? We inhabited every square inch of these continents, and we still do. We still live in the remotest, most northern, desolate, coldest parts of the country, and we won't leave. And we have for thousands of years because we know everything about that land, because we know that that land loves us. So when you know how much that land loves you and the people who live there, whether we're fighting over who gets to fish in this spot first, we know that we're meant to live there together, right? And it's not that we have rights to live on that land or to fish on that rock. It's that we have responsibilities. It's an entirely different perspective on what it means to be human.
Mm-hmm.
We understand that to be born human on Earth is already the lottery win of the universe. We get these minds, we get these bodies, we get this planet, we get these hearts, we get these people, we get this food, we get all this for a little bit of time. And really all we're supposed to do is take care of the place. And we get access to all this. It's the lottery win of the universe. And not only the land must love us, but the universe must love us to give us this shot. And not to blow it.
You know, it's interesting as you talk. I mean, it makes such incredible sense. Like it's like there's no way to even argue against it because it has such profound logic to it. And yet at the same time, you know, I recognize that what you're providing is an argument against this notion of living in the present. You can't live in the present and still have a conversation that allows for the children that are going to come or the ancestors that have been or, you know, to imagine what your actions might do to the lake and the fish and the living beings. You know, this it makes me realize that this whole notion of living in the present, which is a something that people, you know, work towards, is really short-sighted, like literally short-sighted. You can only live in 1 second at a time. You cannot do what you're saying.
Well, it's almost a constant process of choosing unhappiness. I would rather
living in
happy.
The present.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Because we've been told that we have to have a job, that we've got to go to work. And it's this choosing of that unhappy state of not just being, of not just enjoying the land, of not just getting the two fish that you might need to feed your family today and say, that's it, we're done.
Mm-hmm.
We don't need anything else. But we've been taught that we want or we need more. And rather than simply be grateful and absolutely grateful for this amazing planet, as far as we know, this is the best planet in the universe. And we get to live on it. We get to be here. Like the miracle of sitting in the sun. And if the sun is shining, like that sun is, what, 93 million miles away, right?
I have no idea, actually.
7 minutes for the light energy from that sun to get from there to here in space. And then it still has to get through the atmosphere. And we're just far enough away and just close enough that you can feel the warmth of the sun on the skin of your face. What? It's perfect. And we want more. We want better. And what do most humans crave? They want to be loved. They want to be cared for. They want to be
accepted.
Safe.
They want to be accepted.
And
yeah.
You are. And if you recognize that the land is really your first grandmother, and she has held you in her arms your whole life, and she's wrapped her arms around you in her lap, and has told you every second of your life that you are amazing. You are wonderful, and she loves you. And if you let your body and the cells of your body and the molecules of your body know that and feel that and accept that, then it is possible to just be happy.
Mm-hmm.
Because you are so loved already. And then the love of this person or that person or someone other than you, it almost doesn't matter. It's nice. It's one of the great gifts of being human is interaction with other humans. And there's great pleasures and also heartaches. involved in that too, but that's part of the journey.
Absolutely.
And I want all of it. And I'll have some sadness. You know, I had a sad day the other day. We lost an amazing elder. Doris Fox is one of our circle of grandmothers of the downtown east side, and she passed. But she changed so many people, and she's one of the great teachers that I've had in understanding this way of being.
We just need to take a little break here, Norman. I hate to break right at this moment,
yeah,
but we do.
No problem.
And we'll be right back, folks.
Okay.
Eoch Tanuyap, Kuiget Iwans, Kuiens Na. Hi, everybody. My name is Kuiget Iwans. I'm a member of the Squamish Nation and the Yogalanis clan of the Haida Nation. You're listening to Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. We live, work, play, and broadcast from the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations.
You're listening to Rethreading Madness on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox, and I have the great pleasure of speaking with Norman Leech about decolonizing mental health. Kind of giving us a really good idea and description of what decolonizing mental health is and why it's important and really some of the benefits of it. Who would benefit? Well, that's kind of a dumb question. I was going to say, who would benefit from decolonizing mental health practitioner? I think that's pretty evident that it's almost anyone. Is there any form of therapy that it might not work for? So Rethreading Madness, we deal with all forms of mental health, going from anything that is trauma related. And of course, we know, and it's been clearly stated by the psychiatrists out there, so we don't even have to, it's not even an argument, that if we take out everything in the DSM that has to do with trauma, that many hundreds of pages of diagnostic statistics would be reduced down to a pamphlet. So it's really clear in my mind that we've pathologized trauma and people's responses to trauma in our society. But we also deal with things like paranoid schizophrenia, bipolar, yada, yada, all those other kinds of diagnoses that may not have to do with trauma, although even that, I think, is sometimes debated. Is there anybody where this therapy wouldn't work?
Yes, and I think you've touched on it. So I think what has been found is the personality disorders, some of the things that you touched on, the psychopathy, the sociopaths, narcissists, bipolar, borderline personalities, don't respond to the therapy as well. Those are personality disorders that aren't as clearly related to past trauma. So they can be, you know, it's everything's individual, and so there can be some positive outcomes from working with people of those disorders, but it's not nearly as effective as we would hope. And I think that the search is still on for effective therapies for people suffering from personality disorders. So that's unfortunate.
Did you say that's unfortunate?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you have any idea why? I tend to think that everybody on the planet can be, you can engage them in a conversation, you can engage them in reasoning, and even somebody who may be having hallucinations that I can't see. There are ways of initiating a conversation and moving that person through that. I'm not a therapist, so I come from it from a very a support person mostly, but not trained in psychiatry or even
right. And me neither. I'm trained in this one form of therapy. But you make a good observation that this is a newly evolving realm for therapeutic approaches. So it might be that we just haven't touched on it yet. We haven't found it yet. So I think that there probably is. So in the big picture, Indigenous people see things not from the sense of right and wrong, good and bad. we see things in a sense of imbalance. And the goal is always to restore and maintain balance. And so if those disorders are the result of some imbalance, then there should be a way to help restore and maintain balance for those people as well. So we found ways that work for people who are suffering from trauma, and they're effective. And largely it is about helping them see and notice and understand the imbalances that are affecting them. And then to draw on their relations with land and ancestors and many other tools to maintain that balance as well. So I think it's worth really looking further into methods from an Indigenous worldview that can help.
So in the distant past, I'm assuming that anything that looks like a personality disorder, as much as it can occur today, it happened 200 years ago. How would an Indigenous culture, using what you're talking about, work with somebody who maybe is having hallucinations or is antisocial?
Well, again, that's a word that can be simply be visions, right?
Exactly.
Like I know many people who say that they interact with spirits and ancestors, and they thought they were crazy. But as it turns out, no, they're bringers of messages and wisdom and medicines. So it's a perspective, right? Just depends on your point of view. So I think it's worthwhile to look more as to the whole colonized system of psychoanalysis and mental health. Yeah, I think it's ripe for reexamination. But surviving COVID, and everybody who survived COVID was traumatized by it. So in essence, everybody is post-traumatic now due to pandemic.
Yes.
And it's largely undiagnosed and unrecognized and untreated. But everybody's in this post-trauma syndrome now. And a lot of it is fear. Right. So when people are afraid, then they can get overwhelmed by those fears. So, and I know we've worked with people because we worked in, the downtown east side, and people who were isolated, right? They were forced isolation into their little rooms. Mm. And they would start to get afraid that people were watching them and tapping their phones and going into their rooms whenever they left. And they wanted to report those things to us at the community policing center. And we would listen. Mm-hmm. And it would maybe take 20 minutes to take some notes and never make them feel like they're crazy. No.
Exactly.
It's take them seriously and say, okay, so is there anything else? And say that sounds terrible. That would be awful if that happened to me. And simply be authentic and sincere about it. And then they would calm down. And then you would start to ask some questions. Well, is there anyone else you can talk to about this? And usually there would be no one. But after a while, they might think of a neighbor or a friend that they could talk to. And then they would calm down and then they would change their mind about actually making a police report. Simply because they had been listened to and not made to feel as though they're crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And yet that's almost the first response from first responders.
Yes.
If we would just listen and help, sometimes that's all it takes.
That is all it takes. And you're echoing something that we find repeated on this show over and over and over and over, which is that the most powerful form of healing comes from acceptance, whether it's yourself or other people, just being seen and heard and accepted for whoever you are in that moment, in that second, whatever that is.
And I think that almost describes everyone who works in a nonprofit around the world. Is really... all they really sometimes need to do is listen than help. Yes. And they do. And it's so effective and it's so appreciated. Right? So if you think of why every nonprofit in the world exists, each one exists to address some systemic injustice, right? Whether there's a gap in the system for immigrants or refugees or women fleeing violence or children in care or, right? Every nonprofit springs up to address some gap or injustice in the system.
Mm-hmm.
And then seeks government funding or donations to help mitigate the effect of that built-in injustice. Now, the system never simply removes the injustice. No, it maintains the injustice.
Mm-hmm.
But then also underfunds the nonprofit to mitigate the effects of that injustice. Again, another example of the diabolical brilliance of the systems.
Mm-hmm.
So the more we can recognize and start to notice that, holy cow, these systems were actually not designed for healing or health or fairness or justice, that they were designed to separate, to divide, to isolate.
Control.
Each of us, so that we behave in a certain way. And that the path to healing is actually, the more work that I've done decolonizing, and the more people ask me, well, what's the point of decolonizing? What's the end goal? And more the answer is, because it's healing. We all have healing to do from colonization. And the more we do, the healthier we'll be, the happier we'll be, and the more we'll be able to recognize the harms that we're facing every day from these systems.
Mm-hmm. I know that Shirley Turcott is based here in Vancouver, or was anyway, when I knew her way back when. Is decolonizing therapy something that people can access only here on the West Coast, or is this something that has spread across the continent? How far does it reach?
I see more and more facilitators and trainers working in the area of decolonization. I don't know exactly how they're doing it. Like, mine came almost accidentally through these trauma tools and understanding that healing from our intergenerational trauma is absolutely decolonizing.
Mm-hmm.
Because we realize that the source of our trauma has been colonization. And then the source of almost all humans' trauma has been colonization.
Right.
And we're in the unique position here in BC because we're so recently colonized, right? Barely 200 years here in BC, mm-hmm. that we're some of the people on the planet who have a memory, who have an experience, who have of a time before. We have a reference point that we can say, no, actually, this is not better. This is not the best that humans can do. We had ways that worked way more effectively, and we remember them. And we can teach them to you if you're willing to listen. If you ask, we will share. Right? All Indigenous people across the continent were willing to help newcomers mm-hmm. learn how to live as good human beings in those lands. Unfortunately, very few people ever asked. They brought their own laws with them.
Yes, true. Can you give us an example of one of the tools you talk about that people have learned to use?
Well, one is to visualize trauma. So if you notice that someone, like if you walk into a room and something was going on before you got there and you have a sense, that holy cow, you notice.
Mm.
And you notice because, well, you have other senses other than the five, right?
Right.
So colonization will teach all humans that really you only have five senses. So the only things that count are those things that you can hear, smell, taste, touch, and
see.
And the rest aren't real. But we know there's more. and we rely on them because those are the ones that don't lie to us. So if you can visualize and notice that there's trauma in the room, then you can behave, you can adjust your behavior to protect yourself from that trauma and pick up less of it. And also to treat it with the respect that it deserves. And then you can, by your behavior, you can help other people change their behavior toward that trauma. So there's a couple of major, I guess, differences between a colonized way of being and an Indigenous way of being. One is that knowing that there are many more senses beyond the five. There's the sense of connection to land, to each other, to ancestors. That sense of connection is what is behind that, what most Indigenous people, we in many, many languages across the continent, we say, all my relations. And that's all my connections to everything, everywhere, everywhen. And we all had that we know that we're part of, we're connected to everything. And because of that, we know we're not alone. So a colonized way of thinking is that everybody's an individual. Everybody is separate. And those connections aren't real. So in that universe, everyone is ultimately alone. And that's terrifying. That's a lonely universe. And that's not one that I want to live in. That's not a universe that makes sense. I would rather, and that's sort of the choice you get. You either can be part of everything and have access to everything, or you can be separate and be alone. And those are fundamental differences between a colonized worldview and an Indigenous worldview. And part of that is also those other senses that we get access to, that sense of connection. And then it shows up in many ways, those differences. So we're very non-binary in Indigenous worldview. We don't think of things in black and white and right and wrong and left and right. We think of things as an interconnectedness, as a balance of many things, as complex webs of interactions. We're much less patrilineal. We're more matrilineal. We preserve balance rather than, so the justice system is about healing and restoring balance, whereas the colonized justice system is based on crime and punishment, which is based on the concept of sin and penitence, which is derived from the Old Testament of the Bible. Not the New Testament, the Old Testament. So there's fundamental differences, and I actually did workshops on understanding the differences between the worldviews as well, and how it leads to these kinds of behaviors, and how it's so fear-based, colonized systems. They're so afraid of so many things, and they let their imaginations run wild with these imagined fears of the worst-case scenario, which is really generally a one in a million chance, but it rules their behavior,
right?
But if you just look objectively at the universe, it's unfolding exactly as it should, amazingly well, 99.999% of the time, right?
Oh, I believe that absolutely.
But so many people base their behavior on the fear of that 0.001%.
Yeah, we're told that if you do the right things and you live a good life and you work hard, or if you're evil or whatever, you can get ahead. And it's all based on, you know, what you can force upon the world from your being, whether it's good or bad. And I recognize that because I grew up white, and certainly those are the messages. But I've also been intimately connected with the First Nations community, and have come to recognize that, in fact,
the world, you know, your best life is living a good life, but it all just kind of happens. I mean, your job is really to go with the flow, not to, that's my sense. I could be wrong, but my sense is that what happens, happens. It's going to, the world is
and
working just as it should, so long
and
as you just.
It's fascinating. It's absolutely awe-inspiring almost all the time.
Yeah.
And I say, most cultures, when they got back to their pre-colonized time, had this, had very similar relationships to the land and the universe and understanding of what it meant to live a good life.
Mm. We need to stop here. Sorry, but it's
no
true. Can you tell me how someone would find a therapist or mental health professional or support person who works in decolonizing therapy structure?
Yeah, so there's a Facebook page for graduates of Indigenous focusing oriented therapy.
Okay. And is that what it's called?
Yep. And so graduates of ITFL and of the therapeutic approach get to be members, but others, people can probably still see the page and can post some questions and ask for a therapist, and it'll go out to the network.
Okay. All right. That's good to know. All right. And you don't have to be First Nations to engage with.
Oh, no. So I'm working with the Japanese-Canadian community now. Well, like Haruko, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're interested in finding some tools, and they're customizable to other cultures, right? So they have a connection to land, too,
right?
And ancestors, too. So all we have to understand is how they, how it has meaning for them and how it's relevant to them, and customize them so that it's more relevant for them.
Thank you, Norman. I appreciate this. This has been a fascinating conversation. I have no doubt people are going to get a lot out of having listened to you talk about this and to describe it. So thank you.
My pleasure. Have a great day, Bernie.
Hi, folks. This is Steve Ferguson, your 21st century schizoid man, and I'm the host of Prog Rock Alley, inviting you to come down and listen to our show every week at Monday, 1 a.m., the very end of the weekend. We will be looking at all forms of progressive rock. I'm talking about space rock, art rock, math rock, fusion jazz. You want it? I got it. Just name it. I'll play it. We'll see you again. That's here on CFRO 100.5 Co-op Radio, Monday mornings, 1 a.m.
We've been chatting with Norman Leech about decolonizing therapy. I am so grateful for the time he has spent with us today. My thanks to Sherry Alwick for the gift of her music, singing us into and out of each one of our programs. But as always, my thanks goes out to you for joining us today. Stay safe out there.
You've just listened to Rethreading Madness, where we dare to change how we think about mental health. We air live on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO, 100.5 FM, every Tuesday at 5 p.m. or online at cooperadio.org. If you have questions or feedback about this program, or want to share your story, or have something to say to us, we want to hear from you. You can reach us by email, rethreadingmadness@cooperadio.org. This is Bernadine Fox. We'll be back next week. Until then. Just making it.
some kind of magic.